Welcome back. My next guests are being called the hottest musical act to emerge from Sweden since ABBA. They're called the Cardigans, and they write catchy pop songs in their own unique style.
The Cardigans are a Swedish pop rock alternative band formed way back in 1992. After gaining success with their 1994 debut album in their home country, their popularity would escalate when 1996 single Loveful became a worldwide hit. By 1998, the band had become a household name and racked up many more hit singles to add to their repertoire. Having sold over 15 million albums worldwide, wrap up warm as we discover more about the Cardigans.
Again, a big hello from yours truly, Roger Wallace. On this disc, I'm going to present some of the best swinging sounds that have ever come out of Sweden. Sounds like this.
Hi, I'm Peter.
Hello, I'm Ben.
And I'm the little Nina.
And my name is Lasse.
And I'm the Big Magnus.
And we are the Cardigans!
Peter Svensson and Magnus Svenningsson, both heavy metal musicians, formed the Cardigans in October 1992 in Jönköping, Sweden, with drummer Bengt Lagerberg, keyboardist Lars R. Johansson, and lead singer Nina Persson.
When I first met our guitarist and songwriter, Peter, we're both dead tired of being hard rockers, having long hair and all that stuff. So we met back in 89 or 90, and we both discovered mainly British pop bands at that time. So we weren't really hard rockers when we started the Cardigans.
Where did you first meet you two? Where did it happen? Was it in Sweden?
It was actually in my apartment.
Where was that?
In a town called Jönköping in Sweden. And me and our guitarist Peter, we've been playing for a couple of years before, and like summer 92 we decided to form a new band with a female singer this time. So we met a guy who went in the same class in high school as Nina, and he brought her to my apartment for an audition.
Oh, you auditioned Nina? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what did you think when you first heard her?
I think she sang for like...
Well, like when you saw me. I had never been singing before, so I was like, enormously nervous, obviously.
Mm. And what did he ask you to sing?
He didn't ask me to sing anything. I was with our first guitar player, and we had actually written a song together already, which was the very first song of the Cardigans. It's called Poo Song. It was, I think it was a B-side at some time.
And she fitted exactly what you were looking for?
Yeah, I think you sang for like half a minute or so, but... I had to make coffee in the kitchen while she was singing because she was too nervous. But I just like listened to one ear and said like, yeah, this is fine. Let's have some coffee and cookies instead of singing.
So did you, at that stage, want to make it big like this? Did you want to do what you're doing now, which is to tour and to sell and to become, you are professional, you're a professional band. Was that very much in your mind, in your flat, when you were listening to Nina
sing? Of course, that's always.
Dreams, yeah.
I never even had it as a dream, since I was never actually interested in this before I joined the band. And I don't think I had it in mind when I did join the band either, because I honestly only wanted to... Well, I only thought I would keep it as a, you know, spare time thing.
Mm-hmm. Were your parents supportive of your wanting to be a musician?
I didn't want to be a musician, so they were not worried. No, yeah. they were always incredibly supportive of. I was super. When I was younger, I was more into art. I went to art school, and I was more. I was convinced I was going to work with visual arts somehow, and they've always been very supportive of that. And I, you know, when I started to enjoy music, they were incredibly supportive of that too. But I never really strived to become a musician. I was just sort of recruited as a singer to this band. And I was I was bored out of my mind in this small, safe place. So I was like, awesome, I get to hang with the fun guys.
Living together in a small apartment, the Cardigans recorded a demo tape, with Nina providing lead vocals on only one of the songs towards the end of the tracklist. A&R man Ola Hermansson heard the demo and signed the band to his Trampoline imprint.
Hang out, the five of us, quite exclusively in the beginning. It was really sweet. We were like the Monkees TV series, because of course that was something that media really latched onto. And we had a lot of fun, good parties going on. So here's Tambourine Studios. This is actually the record that made us want to come here and record. A handy map of the Soviet Union so that we can pin up our tours when we're conquering the East. So this is where we slept, which is kind of bananas. We literally, like the five of us, slept in this room. That age is really amazing, how happy you are to just sort of, how free you are, and how your, you know, integrity and personal space is so different than it winds up being later in life. I'm a reluctant musician, maybe, and I still haven't bothered to learn to play an instrument. So I'm only a singer, and that's how I write my songs. And I'm almost a little superstitious about that. Like if I would learn an instrument, that I would, you know, pop the bubble a little bit. If it would become a science, it would lose its magic, sort of. Our producer would like build his own drum kits and things to get the right sound. Oh, here it is. Here's an example of the home-built bass drum. It's two bass drums put together. It was messy and charming, it still is, kind of, but this is like haute couture compared to what it was in the beginning.
January 1994 saw the release of Rise and Shine, the official debut single to be released by the Cardigans. It first appeared in 1992 on the limited edition 7-inch EP, The World According To, and was the first Cardigans recording to feature Nina Persson as lead vocalist. Due to the positive response to the track, Nina became the group's permanent lead singer, and the song was re-recorded and released as the first single from their debut album. The band released their album Emmerdale in Sweden on the 18th of February 1994, and later in Japan on the 24th of September. It would be reissued in Europe many years later, in January 1999, and in Canada in May of that same year. Follow-up singles included Black Letter Day, Sick and Tired, the latter being released in September 1994 as the third single in Sweden and as their first single in Japan. The Emmerdale album would eventually be certified gold in both Sweden and Japan. The remainder of 1994 was spent touring Europe and recording new material.
Career highlights of Emmerdale.
Well, that was our first record, and the first thing first thing I recorded and the first thing we wrote and everything. So that was very magical, of course, because it was just the virginity of everything, kind of. It's beautiful, and when I listen to it now, it's really so innocent, sort of, and very sweet.
The first one was pretty big in Japan.
It was weird.
Nothing made sense.
Nothing made sense. We were almost embarrassed how nice people were.
When you got, you know, figures and charts and everything, and you realized that over that year of the second album, we sold more than Madonna or Michael Jackson, who also put out albums that year.
It was quite crazy. We had to check in at the hotels with false names.
1995, Life.
Then we started getting a little more sassy and retro and a little more quirky and more, you know, just more, little more mileage, kind of. That's the most sort of conceptual record we ever did, I feel like. And we really had, I think that's why it aged not as well, or why it's harder to play it these days, because it was so conceptual. It was fun, though, and really good for what it was, but it was a time capsule.
The 16th of March 1995 saw the release of Carnival, which became the lead single from the band's upcoming second album. It gave the group their first appearance on the UK singles chart, reaching number 72 in June 1995. After their next single, a reissue of Sick and Tired, reached the top 40, Carnival was then repressed and reached a peak of number 35. This release also peaked at number 44 in the Netherlands, becoming the band's first single to chart there. Carnival was the first release material by the Cardigans on which Nina received a writing credit, on this occasion alongside bassist Magnus, whom she would later supersede as the group's primary lyricist. Less than a year since their debut, the band's second album, Life, was released worldwide in March 1995 and became an international success, especially in Japan. Outside of Sweden and Japan, where debut album Emmerdale had not been released, Life was pushed as their debut album and would contain a compilation of tracks from both Emmerdale and Life. Life would sell around a million copies, going gold in the UK, platinum in Sweden, and double platinum in Japan. After their success with Life, the Cardigans signed with Mercury Records, under which they began recording their next album.
First band on the moon.
Every record we have made with the Cardigans has been like a counter reaction to the previous one. And by then we were really tired of everybody calling us cute after having done sort of cute and sort of ethereal and sort of a little bit, you know, we felt like we weren't easy listening, we weren't taken serious. So we wanted to be taken seriously, we wanted to be a little more gritty and rocking and. But then we made Love Fool on that record, so we just sort of like totally dug our grave completely.
Well, this record, The First Man on the Moon, is of course different from the others because we've written brand new songs for it. And it's a little bit of the same melancholy as there is to Emmerdale, the first record we made. But we also have some of the cheerfulness from Life, and then there's many other elements that we made for the first time on this record. I think you could say it's a bit, not harder, but it is, not as playful as life. We've tried to take away all the unnecessary details and just get to the basics with the pop songs, keep it simple.
My inspiration for the lyrics is partly from old personal stuff, like old miserable things that I like to dig up again, and some of new experiences. On the Life album, I tend to get inspiration from movies or books or whatever, but this time it's more personal stuff, so I didn't really need the books to get inspired by.
Well, I listened to the lyrics to the single Love Fool, and some more too, but I don't think there's really any, that these songs have anything in common really. I just picked the songs that I felt that I, you know, that I had an idea for.
I think on this new album we have developed parts that we have tried before, like to do heavier sounds, more drums, more bass, to get rid of parts of this silly elements on the Life album. We thought we should try something a bit more serious this time, and a bit more personal lyrics, like we did on our first album, Emmerdale. So I guess it's a kind of a natural development. We wouldn't have done this album if it wasn't for Life. So I guess people will still hear the Cardigans, but slightly different this time. I don't think there's any really need to sound just the same or throughout all albums. And the songs are really good, and the arrangements are really good, and the lyrics are really good, and yeah, Cardigans at its peak so far.
The last album, Live, for us it was the second album, but for almost the rest of the world it was the first album, because it's a sort of compilation between our first and second album. And on that album, with the album sleeve and the arrangements and everything, it was very much 60s stuff, very stylish actually. And that wasn't really what we wanted it for that specific album, but that's what most people think that we are. But now it's more that we're natural. We look like we do every day in the video, and that feels very comfortable.
Love Fool was written by Peter and Nina as the lead single from the band's third studio album. It was first released in Sweden in mid-1996 and on the 9th of September in the UK. In the US, the song was serviced to radio around August 1996. The song was initially a hit in Europe, reaching number 15 on the Swedish singles chart and peaking at number 21 on the UK singles chart on its first release in 1996, and at number 2 when it was reissued in 1997, following its use in Baz Luhrmann's Romeo and Juliet. It then achieved international success, becoming a number 1 hit in New Zealand and peaking just outside the top 10 in Australia at number 11. Love Fool became a crossover hit in the US, reaching number 2 on the Hot 100 Airplay chart. The song was also featured in the 1999 film Cruel Intentions and the 2007 comedy Virgin Territory.
Spent my nights away.
1996 saw the release of the band's new album, First Band on the Moon. It was first released on the 12th of August 1996 and internationally on the 9th of September 1996. The album was a major breakthrough for the band, both in their native Sweden and internationally. The album peaked at number 2 in Sweden, number 4 in Japan, number 18 in the UK and number 35 in the US, where it became their best-selling album.
Bess Luhrmann, I think he heard Carnival from the previous album and really liked that. So he wanted us to write a song for his next movie, Romeo and Juliet.
He wanted us to write a song for his movie because he was a Cardigans fan. But we were in the middle of recording this album, First Band on the Moon, so we didn't have time to write one song for him. So we offered him a couple of songs and he liked Love Fool, so we gave it to him.
And it really worked out well, you can say. It was number one on the radio charts for months and months, like half a year or something like that.
And I think it was played over 1 million times during that year on American radio, which is insane.
Bean It was released as the next single on the 25th of November 1996. The track was less successful than Love Fool, peaking at number 56 on the UK singles chart. The song did become an alternative hit in Canada though, climbing to number 9 on their RPM Alternative 30 chart. After extensive touring and promotion, Your New Cuckoo became the third and final single lifted from the album, released almost 9 months since their previous single on the 25th of August 1997. The song reached number 35 on the UK singles chart. In 1997, the band were approached to submit the theme song for the next James Bond film, Tomorrow Never Dies, but rejected the request due to exhaustion that would be exacerbated by the potential added workload. Nina has since called their decision to turn down the offer one of her biggest mistakes. The Other Side of the Moon, a compilation album featuring B-sides and rarities that never made it onto the albums and were previously only available on singles, was released only in Japan and Australia on the 5th of December 1997. The band would return to the studio between May and July 1998 to start developing tracks for their next album. Many of the songs from the sessions were recorded in Tor Johansson's newly developed Country Hell recording studio in Skurup, Sweden.
How was it to go from just singing to writing, and how did that feel? Like for you on stage?
It actually felt necessary, and I did start to write just like a little bit, just because I happened to like it and it was good what I made. But there was even a point when I had to be telling the band, like, I'm really sorry, but I'm from now on I'm gonna have to write everything or I can't be in the band, because we'd come to a situation where I I had to do all the press. And I, you know, and I had to sort of talk about Magnus's lyrics, and I was like, I have no fucking idea what he's talking about. So I was like, I'm sorry, if I, apparently we can't change the fact that I'm going to have to do all the interviews, and that's okay with me, but then I have to be the one who sort of created what I get to talk about. So this is the deal.
And to interpret it, like on stage, is it's a totally different feeling, right?
That too, to also feel the real motivation. Because I felt like I'm happy to sing like covers and sing other people's songs. I love that too. But in the long run, since Cardigans became our lives, I had to feel like I filled up the shoes I was in, sort of. So it felt great, but it was also a little difficult because I did feel a little bit like an asshole, actually. I had to be like, sorry, move over.
Really?
Yeah, and that was weird at that time.
But like, did they understand that?
Like, they pretty much had to, I think. they did. Yes, they did. They understand. Must. Yes.
1998, Gran Turismo.
Then we wanted to even more sort of take a step away from cuteness and be sort of like... We've always had singles from each record that hasn't really been representative for the whole record. So we wanted to be more. Pro Tools had just arrived, mm-hmm. and we were into like Depeche Mode, and we wanted to just make something that was shinier and less. Just harder, kind of. It was funny, a funny period also. I think that's an amazing record. But every time, and I'm so glad that we have toured with it again, because we got to sort of fill those songs with a little light, actually, because we were really worked out and really dark at the time. It really came from, we were exhausted and really bitter and not liking anything, not liking each other or life or, you know.
For me, it's very moving. I get really moved by it in a way I haven't been before, really. Of course, I've been moved, but this is really for real. This is the Cardigans. Gran Turismo is the Cardigans.
I think that initially when we started to talk about whether we should do another album or no, the only thing we can do is something completely different from before.
You know, we want to do an album that sounds 1998, or maybe 99, but and not 1967 like the previous stuff, but still sort of capture, you know, the Cardigans sound.
After listening to the entire record, we put on Bennett from the last record, First Man on the Moon, which we thought rocked then, and it doesn't. It's such a tiny, tiny sound on that song, whereas the new record is so broad and wide and loud. So it will sound better and bigger in every car stereo in the world.
I think it's a bit more of ourselves this time. And I think everybody has been working much harder than any other album.
The previous three albums, we've recorded them all in the Tambourine Studios here in the city of Malmö. But now our producer Tori has built his own studio in the countryside.
The atmosphere in this place is pretty different, I think, from a lot of studios I've been. And it's very calm and quiet. It's in the country, as we said before. So the nature is outside the window, and we have birds in the morning singing. Gives me inspiration, I guess.
This is my own private attic studio. I just put on the vocals, all of them. So I go down and I get a hard disk from Tor, where we already record all the instruments. And I put it in here and I just sing and sing until I feel fine with it, and then I go down with it and we see if it's something to use. Well, most of the lyrics also I've been working out up here, which is also a good thing about being up here alone. That I write while I sing it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I said it's fine before.
What's new is that we've added some new technical things, and this computer has helped us a lot to do this record.
I think we have changed our music style from, of course, touring a lot after First Been on the Moon, but even on that record you can see some developing to the darker sounds. So it was, I think it's partly a decision and something that happens naturally.
We'll sound the Cardigans no matter what we do.
As a band, do you feel more self-confident?
As a band, yes.
We've done wearing leather now. These
days. It's the first time ever that we dare to be serious. Because before, I wouldn't say that we necessarily all the time try to hide behind some kind of cheeriness, and you know, but there was always, after all, you know, the miserable lyrics, there was a tongue in the cheek, you know, saying. But after all, it's more, I don't think, I mean, that we actually use that as a tool to preserve ourselves, but it's more, much more serious, absolutely, much more, I don't know, honest. You rip me up, you spread me all
around, in the dust of a town. It's pretty much darker. That must be pretty natural. I'm not really a sad or dark person, it's just the music that I really like by heart is always pretty melancholic and beautiful.
Actually have different stories from where we got the name from, trying to be different, but well, to be honest, I choose the truth now, and it's, we've been playing this PlayStation game while we recorded the album called Gran Turismo. It's a good game, I have to say, actually. And well, we thought it was a cool sounding name.
Alright.
And then we found out that in the 50s there were big cars named Gran Turismo, big cruising American cars, and we like that as well. And it's a kind of a game with words. It's this, as tourists, when you feel kind of you don't feel really home in a way.
I think we were pretty fed up with just being called a nice Swedish band. We wanted to just make the sound a bit heavier and thicker.
The 14th of September 1998 saw the release of My Favorite Game, written by Peter and Nina for the band's fourth studio album. The song was released as the lead single from the upcoming record. My Favorite Game found minor international success, reaching number 3 in Sweden and number 14 in the UK. It also charted within the top 40 in several European countries and New Zealand. While it failed to chart on the US Billboard Hot 100 and its radio counterpart, it did peak at number 16 on the Billboard Modern Rock Tracks chart. The song did also peak at number 1 in Greece, and has since gone on to become one of the band's most memorable hits. I don't know what you're looking for. You haven't found it accompanying music video was directed by Jonas Åkerlund and features Nina joy driving on a desert road. It caused controversy due to its imagery of car crashes and reckless driving, and resulted in it being recut to tone down the violence so that it could appear on the music channels. The video is also one of their most adventurous, having numerous different versions and endings. On the 19th of October, the band released their new album, Gran Turismo, with a delayed release date of November 1998 in the US. The album featured a much darker and moodier type of music, mixed with more electronic sounds. The album peaked at number 1 in Sweden and number 8 in the UK. It would also peak inside the top 30 in most European album charts. The album eventually went platinum in the UK and twice platinum in Sweden. Year also saw their song Juice appear on the X-Files the album, the soundtrack to the big budget X-Files movie.
Video for our new single, Erase Rewind.
Erase and Rewind.
The song is about to preserve the right to change your mind, simply. To not be static and to, I don't know, the importance of being plastic.
I'll change my mind.
We have always tried to sort of change things in our music and try to take it further, and yeah, we really practice what we preach.
You know the difference in me. What did you hear me say?
We wanted to do a video where you could see like the full band, because the last video was only Nina driving the car. We're just gonna perform the new single in a, you know, like a rehearsal room, but it's a mechanical rehearsal room. So what happened is that during the song, the walls are like closing in.
No, it's not that I don't know. I just don't want it to grow. It's not that I don't know.
The idea is the directors, and he's a Swede friend of ours. It's called Adam Berg.
Erase and rewind.
just an idea that I've been flying around in my head for a while, and seemed to fit the song and the mood of the lyrics, and I thought that it would fit Cardigans excellently. It's a take from a favorite scene in a favorite film. Well, it's a great scene in Star Wars, and it's just quite simple, you know, them in a room and just being there, and that's what most videos are about.
The fun part about videos is it's probably not making the videos, it's more to you know, the combination of pictures to your music, you know. It's not the actual work that I enjoy, it's more the result.
Second single, Erase and Rewind, was released on the 22nd of February 1999, reaching number 3 in Iceland, number 7 in Italy and the UK, and number 12 in Sweden. It was featured in the 1999 film The 13th Floor during the end credits, and also in the 1999 film Never Been Kissed. I just don't want it to grow. It's not that I band would tour America and Europe during late 1998 and 1999.
On stage you have a persona that you don't really show up at the Sunday dinner with your parents. So it's sort of, you know, they have to get, you know, they have to accept that. But it's, I wonder what goes through their mind, what their daughter is up to. For a month I had the same outfit for every show. I had plastic pants, so I started to get sits on my legs and stuff, so I had to change. So now I'm starting on my new month with the same outfit, so yes, I know.
Your new outfit is great.
Yeah, it's, I have like a new really good one, cool. Yes. I don't ever feel like a sex symbol. And it's just a weird disease of this business too. Whoever's on TV is supposed to be either good looking or sexy, even though, I mean, I was never considering myself anything beyond everybody else before I joined this, and I still don't. It's a very, very weird phenomenon. So, no, I don't, and I don't particularly enjoy being one either. What
did you hear me say? I think he felt that he wasn't 100% into going on tour. You know, he wasn't really psyched about it, and I mean, if you're not really looking forward to go on tour, you shouldn't. What did you hear me say? I said, you know, if we're gonna have someone else, you know, that's not Magnus. Yeah, it's Phil or nothing. During these years, I think we've sort of
grown into more of a rock band than like two first albums were more pop. Sick of all my distress, but I will show
I still care. Today I want to be a rock band.
The 12th of July 1999 saw the release of third and final single, Hanging Around, which reached number 17 on the UK singles chart. The music video was directed by Sophie Muller and is based on the 1965 Roman Polanski film Repulsion, with Nina playing the role of Carol. The 1999 also saw the band grace the stage at Glastonbury. The album and band were nominated for a total of 7 awards at the 1999 Grammys, the Swedish equivalent of the Grammy Awards. Gran Turismo has sold more than 3 million copies worldwide.
Tom Jones, 1999, you guys duetted on Burning Down the House, a cover of a Talking Heads song. What was it like working with Tom Jones?
It was really cool. We were so lame then, because we were like, well, I don't really like Tom Jones' music that much, but I guess it's cool, we'll do it. But then he came and it was such a big deal, because we always lived in Malmö in Sweden, which is a smaller town. It's the third biggest town, but it's a small town. And he came in with a helicopter. It was such a big deal. The Malmö ladies were like, what? And he came and we met him at this restaurant, and he's the nicest man. So, and he loves to talk. It was also really sweet because he loved to talk to us because we were young. And his manager, I don't know if he still is, but his manager was also his like best and oldest friend. And the two of them would have like cognac and cigars and just really get going with stories. And for me, it was amazing too. I didn't really know how to relate to it, but he would like, you know, this gentlemanly little hand on the lower way back, you know, and hold open doors and, you know, that sort of old school kind of protecting the women, whatever. Uh-huh. It was really awesome. It was really fun too, because we recorded our vocals not in the same room, mm-hmm. at the same time. But we did something. I think we just did it because they wanted to take some pictures of us. And it was really hilarious because you would see like the needles on the meters on the board, mixing board. We'd be like, I'm singing and it goes like this. And he just goes like, bam, like that. Right, because it's so, we're such different singers. But it was fun, and we also did a couple of like TV performances together and did some traveling, and he's a genuinely very nice man. It was fun. And so afterwards we didn't say anything more about his music. We were like, I love you. And we, when we many, many years later played Vegas, he had a show there. And he had said back then, he was like, if you ever come to Vegas, just give me a call. You got to come see me. And we were like, let's try it. Let's see. And he was like, oh, hi, Magnus. Yeah, yeah, sure. Put us up on the guest list. And so he's one of, he's a very sort of like, you know, loyal and faithful kind of guy.
In 1999, the Cardigans recorded a duet cover of Talking Heads' Burning Down the House with Sir Tom Jones for his UK number one collaborations album, Reload. The track was released as the lead single from Reload on the 13th of September 1999 and became a hit across Europe and Australia, reaching number one in Iceland, number two in Sweden, and the top 10 in Australia, Denmark, Finland, Hungary, Norway, and the UK.
One is Burning Down the House with the Cardigans. We recorded it with them in Sweden with Tor Johansson, and then we did the video in London. And I remember the director said to Nina, play it cool, and Tom, overplay it. So I said, okay, I can do that, like this. Watch out, you make it, what you're after, like that.
Later in 1999, the track War, originally a B-side to My Favourite Game, was added to the soundtrack to the popular romantic comedy movie 10 Things I Hate About You. The Gran Turismo era was followed by a long hiatus, during which the band members pursued solo side projects. During the band's first break, Peter and Bengt worked on the project Pause with help from Joachim Berg from Kent.
Hit reflections bar, I check my troubles at the door.
And Magnus recorded as Righteous Boy.
Plan to do a solo record because it was, we started to do songs because Niklas is a very good songwriter and we just kind of got really excited about meeting each other, and I think I had been wanting to do something else for a while, but it was more about, I wouldn't do it just for the sake of it, but because I ran into this guy who could do what he did, it was more like, yeah, now is a good time for me to start doing these ideas I've collected. And everything seems to happen pretty randomly for me in my career, even if it seems very planned out. But then, accidentally, record companies didn't want to release it then, so accidentally the song sat around and didn't get to release, which I'm kind of happy for in one way, because I'm glad I got to re-record it, because I think it sounds a lot better now. I can buy you.
Most notably, Nina released an album as A Camp, the collaborative side project between the Cardigans' lead vocalist, her husband, composer Nathan Larson, and former Atomic Swing guitarist Niklas Frisk. A Camp's debut album, also entitled A Camp, was originally recorded with Nicholas Frisk before Nina teamed up with Mark Linkous of Sparkle Horse to re-record it. In doing so, he also contributed some new songs to the record. Nina had been a longtime fan of Sparkle Horse and had referred to them as the best she'd ever heard. After a gig in Lund, Sweden, Nina gave Linkous a cassette of all the demo A Camp songs. When they met again during the recording of his album, Nina mustered up the courage to invite him to produce her project. Linkous listened, liked the songs, and agreed.
You don't, and I can hire you, oh yeah, oh yeah, but I can't make you love me, I can't make you care.
We have done so many Cardigans records, so we know how things are supposed to sound. This is my first one, so I have nothing to be based in at all.
You wrote the lyrics with somebody who is called Niklas Frisk.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we say it in
English? Yeah, we wrote the music and the lyrics.
So that's together. A long story. This album is in fact a long story, right? Because you met Niklas Frisk, I read, one day. Can you tell us about this meeting?
Yeah, it was quite a long time ago, like 97, I think.
And we met 3 years ago, 4 years
ago? And we met in the bar and we started talking about records, and then we said it would be fun to try to work together and do something, some sad and beautiful music. So
sad,
then we actually,
sad.
Yeah.
You said sad. Why sad?
Because we were really badly wanted to make sad music. I don't know why, because it's so much more fun to make sad music.
Why?
It just is. I don't know. It's more a point to make sad music than to make happy music.
So you think A Camp is a sad album?
It's quite melancholic, yeah.
Hmm?
It's sad but hopeful, sort of.
Hmm.
So we actually started to play and write stuff together, and then we recorded also. But it was a really good meeting.
Did you think it took a long time to give birth to this album?
No, not at all, because back then we actually did record it once in order to make it a record in the studio, so it was finished then, but then the record companies didn't want to put it out, so it was just sitting around and waiting for years. And then last year I had some time off, so I decided to just take all the material and go and re-record it and like make it fresher and finally get it out. So
and how did your group reacted when you told them I want to do an album solo? Happy or proud or
it was
stressful?
Like the first time I did it, 97, 98, it was in another break from the Cardigans. So mm-hmm. They didn't even know. I think I didn't almost not even tell them that I was doing it, because we had a time off from each other. But then eventually I told them, oh, I made a record. But then it didn't come out, so I don't think they thought of it too much. But then
they didn't think it would come true.
No, yeah, exactly. And then last year I was like, okay, now I'm really gonna... Then I told them, now I'm gonna record again and I will put it out and I will tour and all that. And I don't know, I mean, in a way it's like we... I don't know how they react, but they...
They were not very happy in the way you say things.
I think they are, but it's more that there's nothing they can say anyway, because you can't work in that way, that you only can work within one frame. Because then it'll be... And that's quite obvious. I would be really tired of Cardigans if I hadn't had the opportunity to do something else as well.
But now you're going to be happy to work with them again.
Yeah,
new experience.
Exactly,
right?
And just because now I have a natural outlet for my other ambitions, and Cardigans can keep doing the same thing. So it was sort of, for me, it was a necessary thing to keep doing Cardigans at all.
So now that you have experience working alone and working with your group, what is it that you like the most?
I think I need both very much.
Really?
Yeah.
You but think if that I, without
if
the
really,
group?
If I really, really had to choose only one, I would choose my own stuff.
Why?
Because that I always have with me, and I can do it anytime.
Hmm. more freedom.
Yes.
Yeah.
And but the Cardigans is something, it's a pride to keep doing it too, in a way. It's something like a restlessness. But now we've achieved so many good things, so it feels, it would be stupid to stop such a good project. That's the way it feels. But it's like, you know, if you have a job, if you had a job and somebody gave you the opportunity to choose between your doing your job or your hobby full time, you would choose your hobby.
Yeah, right. So that's your hobby.
It's the same thing, sort of. Yeah, well, now it's obviously my work too, because I work a lot on it, but it's something new, at least. It's something refreshing.
Did you give ideas to the other members of the group? Do they now want to make their own album solo, or they don't even think about it?
Well, actually, Peter did, the guitar player, he did a solo album in 98.
Mm-hmm.
And Magnus, the bass player, is making one right now. So there's three of us.
Okay.
That are doing it. Two guys are not very interested in doing solo things, so they have been studying different things instead. But I think we all had like a puberty time.
So let's come back to the album Camp. We were talking about the lyrics. You like sad songs. Do you have themes you really like writing about, or themes you didn't write about and you would like to write about?
I think I pretty much go on about the same themes always when I write, like in the Cardigans and in the Camp. And the subject would be like frustrating love situations, frustrating love, bad love. And
is that a personal album? Do you think so?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Love is hard, but it's good. But it's like love and death are always making people do really weird things, and I think that's very interesting.
So you want to keep on with those themes?
I don't think I can do much else. I've been trying occasionally to do, like, singing about the world and about, you know, different things, but it doesn't really work. I have more thoughts when it comes to these subjects. And, like, about feeling left over, obviously, and isolated, different weird, I mean, different things like that, in that field. Like, I think it's all about people interacting, at least.
So, Camp is the name of this album. It's not the name of none of your song on the album. Why did you choose Camp?
Because when we recorded the first time in 98, we went up to Värmland,
mm-hmm.
in the woods.
In Sweden?
In Sweden, and it was very cold, very much snow and everything. And it was me and Niklas, and then it was like a couple of different random musicians. So it felt a little bit like we were going on a camp.
Yeah.
It was like, we packed our bags and went up there and slept in bunk beds and went for walks. It was like, I like to think about this project as a camp, but I will hopefully always be the camp leader. But then the camp members can differ between the records and, you know, go different places.
So that's really the image of your album, the thing you just described.
I like to think of it that way, yeah.
Yeah. The first single out of this album is called I Can Buy You.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by I Can Buy You? Do you think we can buy somebody?
I think the song is ultimately about being really, really desperate for love, and so desperate that you would, you know, if you can't get it by any other means, then you can try to buy people. I think you can buy, there's certain people that you definitely can buy.
Yeah.
Obviously. But I don't think it's necessarily the people you need.
No.
That you can buy.
Definitely not.
No.
I don't think so.
But I think it's an interesting image, because I'm sure that everybody in some point in their life have been thinking that, been so, you know, wanting something so badly that if you could buy it, you would go straight to the bank and take a bank loan and buy it.
Is it your favorite song on this album, or you don't have any favorite song?
It's still hard for me to pick out songs, but I think it's a really good, I mean, even when we wrote it, I think
did
we
you choose
about
this
it.
One? Did you choose this song as your first single?
Yeah, because I think I remember even when we wrote this one, which was a long, long time ago, I think even when we sat there and wrote it, we said that, wow, this must be a single at some point, because it was very somehow easy to write, and songs that come out easily reach people easy too.
Yeah,
so it's like
easy to listen
direct
to.
And natural good music, sort of. So I think that's still one of the most fantastic songs I've ever achieved, in a way. I'm not sure it's my favorite one, but sometimes it's just fun to realize that you can write songs that you can play on the radio, too.
True. Did you experience being on scene alone, or not yet?
Yeah, I did. Last week we played two English festivals, and we had a show of our own in London as well.
That was your first time?
Yes, except for in 98 we did two shows with a camp, whereof one was in a pizzeria. Really cute. But yeah, this time around it was the first time we played it live.
Yeah, so how do you feel? Is it different again? Is it different to...
That's not really very different. Just being on stage is always the same kind of experience.
Yeah.
But it's nice.
No more fear? A little bit more,
there
I
think. There was less fear. But I think it was less fear.
How can you explain that?
Because I've chosen this in such a different way than I've chosen the Cardigans before. You see what I mean? This is, in a way, like just the fact that I've made this record and I've gathered the people that play with me and everything, it makes it feel so much easier somehow. I don't know why.
Yeah, but the pressure is still the same when you're on stage.
Yeah, maybe
when you're... Well,
I think I feel that it's... This feels easier in a way. I think there's... I feel more pressure on the Cardigans because we have...
Oh, you do still now?
Oh, yeah. Because we have done records before. People have something... They expect something from us.
Mm-hmm.
And this is my first record, and people came to my shows and they haven't even heard the record, and that's a huge freedom.
Yeah.
They can't hear if you play wrong because they don't know how it's supposed to sound. But.
Which is funny because usually when somebody, because it's not the first time, a lot of people who are in groups start a solo career, they feel a lot of pressure and are very stressed about coming out with an album. You don't feel stressed with this album at all? Because you know, maybe it's because the Cardigans are still there. Maybe they help you in that way, don't you think so?
I don't know. I think one reason might be that I've been working on this music for so long, because 4 years is a long process of living with songs before you release it. I think that's one thing, that I have reconsidered these songs many, many times, many more times than you do if you're just going to a studio for a couple of months to make a record. I think that's a big reason. And I've had the opportunity, it's not very often you have the opportunity to record one record twice.
Okay, but just imagine for 1 second that you don't have the Cardigans anymore because you split off, or I don't know. Anyway, you come out with this album. If you don't succeed, it's much more important for your personal career. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So in that way, maybe you don't feel pressure. No, you never thought about it.
No, because there was never, I mean... No, I'm not really like that either.
Well, you feel cool anyway with this album.
Yeah,
that's very good. Okay, anyway, as a solo artist, now that we can say that you are a solo artist, if you could choose someone with who you could perform, like, you know, there are so many duets, who would it be?
If I could choose anyone, I think
like
I would choose...
Like a duet.
Yeah. Johnny Cash or Neil Young. Would be amazing.
And who are they?
There's two still living legends to me. Johnny Cash is, they're both like in sort of like American. Johnny Cash is a pretty faithful country musician, has done pretty like traditional country music, but he sings fantastic. He has a fantastic voice. And he's kind of dark minded and really.
He likes dark-minded. He likes sad songs.
Yeah,
he likes black things.
I don't know.
Black color.
It's very appealing somehow.
Yeah. How can you explain that?
I don't know. It just makes you curious somehow. I don't know.
It makes you realize how happy you are.
It's really funny because the people with the darkest minds mostly have the best sense for humor.
Really?
Yeah, I think so. And that's... And Neil Young, by the way, is another American artist who's more like in the rock school, but with some flirtations with country music.
Yeah, how would you classify your music?
I've been calling it Euro country because it started with me being very inspired by country music, but it sounded more country music when I recorded the first time. And last year we actually took away some country influences because I didn't feel like... I didn't want to talk about country music all the time, and I don't want to do like a pretending to, you know, Nina goes to Nashville
put on the cowboy hat mm-hmm. record, because I'm not, I think you have to have a certain background to get away with a pure country record.
So what are your musical influences? Black music too? Dark music? Who did you listen to when you were a kid?
When I was a kid, the only like idols I can remember was Donna Summer and Joan Jett. I've been listening.
That's not dark music.
No, I really like a lot of like not dark music as well. But it's something that, you know.
And is there somebody who gave you the envy to sing and to do this job?
No, not really, because I didn't really choose or discover that I wanted to sing until I joined the Cardigans.
Mm-hmm.
So it was more, no. I never had any role models that I want to be like him or like her in that sense.
And as a Swedish girl, do you like Swedish music?
Yeah, there's a lot of really good stuff.
Yeah, like what?
Unfortunately, it's all things that never seem to get commercial, but there's one band that's really fantastic called The Soundtrack of Our Lives.
Mm-hmm.
And there's actually two guys from that band in my band now. So of course I like them. And there's a really good band called Silver Bullet, really good rock band.
Mm-hmm.
Another good band called The Hives. And
And what do you think about, of course I have to ask you about ABBA. Did you like them?
They were really good songwriters.
So now how are you going to manage this double career? You're not afraid of it. I don't feel you afraid of it, but
I'm not afraid of it, but I'm aware that I might kill myself with work.
But that's good. It's good to kill you.
Okay.
With work it's
be
better than
bit,
with
yeah.
something else.
Yeah.
As a dark-minded girl.
I just have to be aware. I think I need to maybe get a week holiday in between other projects, maybe. Mm. Then I'll be fine.
If you had not succeeded as a singer, what would you have done as another job? What other job?
I don't really. That's really a hard question, and I, in a way, I was saved by the music because I didn't have an idea what I wanted to do.
Mm.
And then I joined the band, and suddenly that became my job. But when I joined the band, I was in art school, so I probably would have done something in that field. I think, but this is also what I think now. Now I think I should have become a photographer.
Yeah.
But I can't really remember if I wanted to back then. Like, some kind of arty-farty thing.
Okay, anyway, singer is good.
Yeah, it's really good. But if I now would get a completely new life to start over, I would become a doctor.
Oh, that has nothing to do.
No, I'm really... No, I love my job. It's really fantastic. But I wish I could have another life, because I'm a little bit sad that I didn't get to do any academic studies or any, like... You don't really save a lot of lives when you make records.
Mm. You still can.
Yeah, if I'd started to study to be a doctor now, I would be done by 40.
Yes.
And it's a little bit sad. It leaves me a little very short time in the profession.
What's your dream today?
I'm really psyched to go on tour, actually, with this.
With this album?
Yeah.
Alone?
Mm.
So it's exciting in a way to perform alone.
Yeah. Well, I have another band. It's without the Cardigans. Guys.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
I know.
Another group of people, so I feel really safe.
But people don't see it that way, you know? Now they can see you as a solo artist. It's good that you feel this way.
The debut album spurned the singles I Can Buy You and Song for the Leftovers. The album was released on the 3rd of September 2001 and reached number 87 on the UK Albums Chart, but peaked at number 1 in Sweden. The success of the Acamp project would become a huge influence in the direction of the next Cardigans record.
to dream of new beginnings when the end is all around. I think you're all right. You qualify for being my super.
But I think because I've learned so much and developed so much myself, it'll be hard not to bring that into the Cardigans. But we're still going to keep doing Cardigans songs, and I have no real pretensions to go into the Cardigans and take over or anything like that. It's more, of course, I will just add things that I learned. I think there's also several members in the Cardigans, apart from myself, that have been doing different projects outside of the Cardigans in this gap. So I think we're all going to come back with a lot of new aesthetics and ideas.
2003, Long Gone Before Daylight. Now, a lot of people say that album is very country influenced.
It's very Americana influenced, for sure. We all looked the same, and we all had very long hair and very long beard. And that's the record we did. So after Gran Turismo, we didn't have a good relationship. And Long Gone Before Daylight is what came out of it when we very conscious. That was conscious coupling, because we needed to. We rented a house in Santa Monica actually for 2 weeks on the beach, and we were not even first. We weren't allowed to bring instruments because we were only gonna talk, and eat and drink and have and become friends again, kind of, and we did. But after like 3 days. Peter was like, I'm just going to go get an acoustic. So he did. And then we wrote the first song on that record called Communication. So that was it's really beautiful. It's like one of these, it's like the opposite of a breakup record.
Då när vi skulle göra Long Gone så påbörjade vi någonting och det, sen så kändes det bara som att bandet och Tore var väl inte riktigt i fas liksom. Och under de åren då vi inte hade jobbat tillsammans så hade han skenat iväg kanske åt ett annat håll och vi åt motsatt håll. Det var ömsesidigt, han kände likadant liksom att jag lämnar nog det här nu för det känns ändå som ni har någonting på gång och sådär.
Det är inte för jävla grötigt då?
Nej.
Och det visade sig då efter ett par månader att det gick inte så bra och så skildes vi åt då. Man kan säga att de ville göra sin skiva och behövde väl egentligen inte så mycket en producent som en kreativ tekniker. Så jag tappade tålamodet och ville vidare och sådär. The ones I made friends with, the comfort of fireflies.
From 2002 to 2003, the band reconnected to start work on their next project. The music coming from these sessions differed greatly from much of the band's earlier work, eschewing the pop and electronic sound of previous material in favour of a sparser alternative rock and country influenced production. Its lyrical themes were also more mature, with subject matter inspired by domestic abuse, depression, love and fatalism.
I'd say it's not a bad world.
This new record, I think the warmth and the sort of perception that it's us five playing together in the same room as the listener. That's what we try to achieve.
In a way, I would like to say that it's more bright than the last record, but it still certainly has a lot of melancholy and darkness as well. But I think it's mainly warmer in a way. It's not positive, but it's warm. It's a very understanding record, kind of.
Long Gone is
compared to Gran Turismo, our last album, it's a very warm album and natural sounding, and it's by far the best album we've done so far.
It was recorded over a period of 9 months, more or less. That wasn't the plan from the beginning, it just happened because we weren't satisfied until after 9 months. But the whole idea was to play together, the five of us, and do like more or less a live album.
What It's Worth is the kind of a pop song that has that fantastic quality that I always kind of fall in love with. It starts here, it starts with loads of energy, and it goes on like a big block like that, and then it ends, and it never lost like a percentage of the energy ever.
For What It's Worth was released on the 10th of March 2003, reaching number 8 in Sweden, number 31 in the UK, and number 37 in Ireland. Released in Japan on the 19th of March 2003 and in Europe on the 24th of March, Long Gone Before Daylight received generally positive reviews from music critics, with several reviewers commending it as the band's best album, while praising their compositional work and the change in musical direction. Several US publications did criticize the band for abandoning their old pop sound and accused them of being ashamed of their former material. The band won 3 awards at the 2003 Grammys, the Swedish equivalent of the Grammy Awards. Long Gone Before Daylight won the Album of the Year award, while the Cardigans won Rock Group of the Year.
I think the first track on the album, called Communication, is definitely my favorite song. It's probably the best song I've written so far.
Communication, I think it adds up the essence of the album.
It feels like kind of a classic.
Yeah.
There's so many, it's really hard to choose one because there's many different qualities. That's the classic song.
Yeah.
In that way it's best.
The second single, You're the Storm, was released on the 2nd of June 2003 and the 14th of July in Europe, and went on to win the award for Video of the Year at the Swedish Grammys. The track charted at number 10 in Sweden and number 74 in the UK.
Feel my heart again.
The third and final single, Live and Learn, was released on the 3rd of December 2003. Long Gone Before Daylight would go on to be certified 2x platinum in Sweden and gold in Denmark.
And then 2005, Super Extra Gravity.
That's, we've never done a follow-up record as quickly ever. So that one came really, it was done quickly after Long Gone Before Daylight. It was also made, we spent 9 months making Long Gone Before Daylight. So Super Extra Gravity we did in 2 months or something. Mm-hmm. We were just tired of it being so draining, you know, and serious and heartfelt, so we just wanted to move up a little bit more. It's a more restless record. I love that record. It's also the latest one we've done, so I always, that's what I'm mostly attached to. I love it. It's really, I was, for me, it's the record where I really, wallowed in this fun thing of pretending to be somebody quite unlikable, you know. I play a different kind of pretty not awesome characters in that, and it was really fun.
Det var också rätt tydligt varför det inte funkade på förra skivan. Vi var rätt så envetna med vad vi ville göra. Vi behövde göra just den grejen då också, var så här kompromisslöst bandiga och allvarliga liksom, och vi behövde göra det, så köra den grejen i botten på något vis liksom. Och det, han gjorde ju sin grej på den skivan också. Han stoppade oss när vi blev för pretentiösa på något vis, men då så lät vi oss inte bli stoppade i den. You're losing a friend.
You got it all wrong. Nu är vi ju här på Rosenlundsvägen 24. Och när vi började repa på den här skivan så repade vi bara 2 kvarter härifrån. Och det fanns ingen toalett på det stället. Så vi gick hit till studion för att låna toalett. Och då var Tore här och jobbade med ett annat band. Och då kände vi väl bara så här att ska vi inte testa igen liksom.
Så när vi började prata om att göra en ny skiva då inför det här, så var det nog inte liksom det första man tänkte att vi skulle göra den tillsammans med Tore. Men på något sätt när vi kom under full med det här att vi inte skulle göra liksom en... Att det inte skulle kunna bli en uppföljare till förra skivan. Den här gången så vill vi verkligen ha någon som så här kommer in och rör om lite i grytan.
Det är klart, det kändes lite sådär, oj då. Det gick inte så bra förra gången. Men på något sätt, jag hade nog i alla fall en tro på det. Och dels för att känna att man ska ju inte ge upp så lätt heller. Utan vi får göra ett försök till.
Det kändes tråkigt att vi inte kunde fullfölja med Tore. Och det kändes också som att det skulle vara spännande att se var han stod idag. Eftersom han alltid har gjort ett sånt otroligt bra jobb med oss på våra tidigare 4 skivor. Då.
Och när de då hörde av sig igen nu inför denna skivan så blev jag väldigt överraskad, för det hade jag faktiskt inte väntat mig. Det kändes lite som att... Nej, det kommer nog aldrig bli något mer med Cardigans oss. Inte för att vi blev ovänner eller så, men bara att det kändes ju lite som ett misslyckande där förra skivan. Inte för att den blev dålig, utan jag menar om vårt samarbete då kändes som ett misslyckande. Och det var det ju. Det var lite revansch liksom. liksom kul. Kul att jag fick en chans till. Nu jäklar ska det bli bra.
Det var jag som frågade honom och jag kommer ihåg att det kändes som att han blev lite förvånad. Fast jag var ju också förvånad på något sätt. Så att, men det kändes skönt efteråt för att det kändes som att vi fick prata igenom allting. Va? Så att allting var utraderat, det som var för på något sätt.
Denna gången har vi verkligen varit öppna för att Tore ska komma in och komma med idéer. Och förra skivan var vi nog mycket med att vi skulle sitta och spela tillsammans i bandet och inte så många fick ha så mycket att göra med arrangemangen. Tore är väldigt, väldigt duktig på att sitta och lyssna på en låt en gång och sen peka på svagheter eller vilka delar man ska poängtera ännu mer.
Så vi frågade om han inte skulle ha lust att producera hela nya skivan. Och det tyckte han lät spännande.
De skivorna som har gått bäst för oss, alla våra hits genom tiderna till exempel, det är ju Tore och Cardigans verk. Liksom. Jag tror faktiskt att då är vi som bäst. You can really make anyone you wanna make. Anyone you need tonight I'll be. Whether you want empathy, animosity, an enemy or company, call me. I can even be nothing if you ask, I'll turn it. For the good times and the bad times that we'll have.
I need to take a break, I'm already sort of...
Okay, sure. Take a break.
Jag är ganska lat när jag jobbar. Eller jag vill. Jag tycker det är lite jobbigt. Sådär. Jag tycker det är jobbigt att prestera. Jag blir nervös och grejer. Så jag vill egentligen bara hela tiden gå hem. Det hade varit ett väldigt jobbigt jobb att ha. Om man inte känner så starkt för det.
Jag har varit in på spinettet så.
Peter har alltid varit sån att han har haft arrangemangsidéer för i princip alla instrument. Men väldigt mycket mer så i början av vår karriär. För mig är det ingen större hot att Peter skulle hitta på schyssta basgrejer utan då gör hon till mina.
Det är helt omöjligt att komma ihåg. Jag ska aldrig spela det live, även om det är bra.
Det har väl alltid varit så att jag är den som är alltid har varit mest driven ända sedan vi startade det här bandet. Så jag är väl och fingrar i det mesta. Men det är väl också en kombination av det faktumet av att jag intresserar de bitarna och tycker att jag har någonting att erbjuda när det kommer till produktionen i sig.
Det känns som du har blivit stressigare på de två sista tagningarna, de två första. Måste du hem?
Det har blivit extremt mycket attityd i den låten, känns som. I Ninas uttryck och texten och sådär. Liksom. Jag tycker den är jätterolig. Jättebra.
Bra gjort, Tore.
Ja, mycket bra gjort, Tore.
Ja, alltså ni har ju också liksom varit en del i det här. Va? Ni, alltså, alltså, det hade ju aldrig låtit lika bra ifall liksom, ni inte hade kommit och spelat åtminstone.
Men det hade kunnat låta bättre. Jo.
Good morning, Joan, now pick up your phone. It was bad, but just a dream. And you all remember.
That's better.
Put on something pretty, go back to the city. In town, the sky's just space. No starlight in your face.
Jag känner jättestor press. Jag tycker det där är så himla viktigt. Jag lyssnar så mycket på text i annan musik också. Och jag tycker det är skitviktigt. Så jag känner jättestor press. Jag har så höga krav på det där. Men vissa dagar så känns det verkligen att det är bara skit allting.
skriver alltid texter om olycklig kärlek och hur jobbigt allting är. Så man kan ju ibland undra hur hon har det i sitt äktenskap. Men jag tror att kanske 10% är självupplevt och sen resten är reflektioner om andras liv eller bara idéer.
För jag tror att skulle jag tala ordentligt, eller helt och hållet tala självbiografiskt och sanning i mina texter, det blir ganska tråkigt egentligen. Så det är klart att det är sensationskryddat lite. Rätt mycket är nog också bara betraktelser av andra. Betraktelser av Magnus, kanske. Ett förhållande där man tjafsar, ja, liksom, tycker man ju det är ju jävligt så här sexigt att sjunga om. Och det räcker ju inte, därför skriver man en text om det, för man måste packa fullt av nyanser liksom, för att verkligen kunna förklara det. För det låter ju bara torrt. Jag har så svårt för att förklara mina texter, för jag känner att de blir så reducerade. Jag har alltid en instinkt att bara säga, ja men det står ju där ju i texten, du får läsa. Ganska nyligen fick jag liksom ett riktigt jävla fan som var så här otroligt otippad också. Det var liksom en riktig så här inkonst indiepoppare som kom fram till mig efteråt. Jag trodde han skulle, ja, hellre att han skulle gå fram och ha en fyllig utläggning för vilka sällans vi valde någonting. Så bara hade han en sån lovebombing och det var helt fantastiskt, för då hade han lyssnat på vår förra skiva när han, jag tror att han var liksom i ett uppbrott i en relation eller någonting. Och han sa verkligen att den hade räddat livet på honom, den skivan då. Han var förtjust i mig för jag har gjort den skivan och jag blev helt förtjust i honom, för han räddade liksom mig den kvällen också för att han sa det sådär. Och det är alltid lika häftigt faktiskt. Jag blir alltid såhär, jag försöker komma ihåg och verkligen tacka folk när de gör sig besväret och säger det till mig, att de har blivit påverkade. För det, alla gör inte det och jag, det är väldigt... Det är verkligen helt fantastiskt och jag blir glad när folk liksom bryr sig om att låta oss eller mig veta det.
Så när Peter skriver låtar, han skriver ju dem i sin ensamhet liksom, för det allra mesta på akustisk gitarr. Och så gör han för det mesta demos och sen så mejlar han dem till oss. Den demon man har hört honom spela, det är så svårt att liksom bortse från det sen. För då är det på något sätt att det är så låten ska vara. Liksom. Medan för honom är det bara ett sätt att liksom försöka presentera melodin.
När det blir repris på refrängen, if you were less like diggy dum, hörde man där nu. Okay. 3, 4.
Nej. När jag skriver de här melodierna så brukar det liksom poppa upp liksom ord också sådär. Men jag skriver ju aldrig hela texter och det ska vi alla vara väldigt glada för.
Jag önskar att han bara skulle kunna sjunga la 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 la. Istället för att hitta på ord, för jag blir väldigt påverkad av det som han skriver. Ibland är det jättebra, ibland så sabbar det hela min process. Sådär.
Ibland så tror jag hon upplever det liksom frustrerande då kanske. Va? För att det, fan, det låter ju snyggt, men det är jävligt rövigt det som jag ska sjunga. Liksom, och det går inte att skriva någonting kring det. Liksom, sådär. Så det, och då är det kanske frustrerande att hitta någonting som låter lika bra, men som faktiskt säger någonting.
Phone. It was bad, but just a dream. And you-
Peter har ju alltid varit den där lite kluriga killen som sitter... Alltså jag har ju en bild av honom att han går aldrig hemifrån, utan han sitter där hemma och liksom låtsas titta på tv, men han har alltid en gitarr och sitter alltid och plinkar på gitarren.
Så jag satt väl och klinkade någon kväll på den där och så bara lät det roligt helt plötsligt. Så blev det en låt av det då som... Skickar iväg två låtar sådär fredag kväll, man har jobbat med en hel vecka liksom. Och sen så sätter vi oss och ska käka. Så jag ska bara gå och kolla om jag har fått några e-mail. Och sen håller jag på så, kan jag hålla på och kolla mitt e-mail 10 gånger om dagen i 2 veckor. Ingen som har liksom skickat. Och jag tror att det kommer sig av att de tror att i vissa fall kanske då att jag inte bryr mig om de tycker att låtarna är speciellt bra eller inte. Medan det är precis tvärtom. Den största bekräftelsen som jag söker är nog hos de andra 4 i bandet. Och det tror inte jag att de har en aning om.
Så det är ju liksom vad alla producenter gör. Ens jobb, det är ju att vara någon utanför. Det gäller ju att vara den som liksom har distansen till att kunna se helheten. Och distansen till det hela, det är ju också att bandet skriver låtarna, de lever med låtarna ett tag. Sen så kommer låten till mig utan att jag har hela den där liksom förhistorien.
När vi sätter oss ner och börjar spela, då låter det på ett sätt. Liksom. Sen kan Tore komma in och så rycker han ut ett instrument och liksom vänder på det. Och då blir det liksom helt annorlunda.
När han kommer in så är det ofta efter att vi har repat låten ganska länge och då har vi liksom kört in oss. Då sitter han med liksom i replokalen och liksom lyssnar och kommer med ganska så raserande synpunkter.
Den kapade takten tycker jag är jättebra. Det är fräscht. Mellanspelet är ju konstigt.
Cardigan skriver så bra låtar och de kan utföra det och göra det snyggt och prydligt, men är vi nu i en studio och ska vara lite kreativa så tycker jag ändå man kan ta ut svängarna liksom, och göra det lite skandalöst.
Jag tror att Tore har lite problem när det blir för vackert, så det ska bli lite fulare och skräpigare. Samtidigt som vi vet att så fort Nina börjar sjunga så kommer det ändå låta ganska sött och vackert. Så vi har verkligen låtit honom sitta med och bara kasta ur sig idéer och så provar vi det. Hur galna de än kan låta.
Alltså det behöver inte vara så jävla smart det man säger. Bara man säger någonting för så kanske någon annan får någon idé. Och en artist kan ju känna kanske lite trygghet i att det är någon som verkar ha en vision eller en idé.
Tore är bra på att ta fram liksom kontrasten i det hela och vi som band har ju blivit äckligt eniga om allting. Men sen inser man liksom efter ett tag, men det här blir mycket roligare. Det här säger ju mycket mer liksom än att bara måla med samma färg hela tiden. Liksom.
Alltså det haglar ju sånt här liksom AC/DC eller Motorhead eller liksom Pet Shop Boys eller vad nu. Pet Shop Boys kanske inte haglar av, men hela tiden så använder man ju referenser, för det är väldigt svårt att beskriva musikvisioner. Så oftast får man använda sådana exempel.
Låtsas att du är liksom en 50-tals trummis, kan han säga. Och då vet jag inte riktigt vad det är, men så försöker jag på något sätt tillmötesgå honom. Liksom.
Det bästa är ju när man börjar med att skapa en gemensam vision. För då blir det bara en sorts process och diskussion för att komma fram till den där gemensamma visionen. Och då blir det nästan aldrig några konflikter.
Av princip så gör han tvärt emot, och det funkar liksom i det här. Och sen har han dessutom något fel på hörseln, jag hört. För jag tror det är diskant han inte hör speciellt bra. Så det är någonting alltid i hans ljudbilder som blir speciellt på grund av det.
Nej, jag tjurar ju inte. Det gör jag inte. Jag är bara liksom irriterad och onöjd.
Fucking producer of the year.
Jag vet inte, men det var väl, du vet, man sitter och tittar på TV och så sitter man och klinka lite, och så helt plötsligt så bara... Jaha, vad är det där då? Jaha.
Börjar nog med det där gitarrriffet som är i början. Det känns som en sån här typisk Peter-Cardigans grej liksom.
Nu byter du ackord på fel ställe. Alltså det ligger ju...
Först har man det här lite för långa introt på låten, men som bara är fantastiskt häftigt med de här ljuden och liksom de här kommandorna som Nina ger då liksom. Och sen så kommer det här liksom lite abrupt avslaget, och så kastas man in i en asball och skithäftig vers. Here's a good man and a pretty young girl.
Texten kom inte först, för det har aldrig hänt och det kommer nog aldrig hända heller. Men den låten hade jag faktiskt givit Peter. Den raden, I need some fine wine and you need to be nicer, den hade jag fått i huvudet någon gång. Så den gav jag till Peter på en lapp.
Så sa bara ni så här, jag har en textrad, I need some fine wine and you need to be nicer. Så här, ja, det är jättefint, så det skulle man ju kunna göra en låt som heter så.
After a short hiatus, the band returned with new single I Need Some Fine Wine and You Need to Be Nicer as the first taste of material from their upcoming album. The single was released in September 2005 and was a hit in Sweden, where it debuted and peaked at number 3, but it was not commercially successful elsewhere, peaking at number 59 in the UK. The 14th of October 2005 saw the release of the band's sixth and final studio album to date. It was produced by Tor Johansson, who last worked with the Cardigans on Gran Turismo. The album was released in Germany and Ireland on the 14th of October 2005 and in the UK on the 17th of October. A Japanese edition was later released. The album would peak at number 1 in Sweden, but sadly only managed to scrape in at number 78 in the UK. The second single was Don't Blame Your Daughter, Diamonds, released in February 2006. Don't blame your daughter, that's just sentimental. And don't blame your mom for all that you've done wrong. The track would peak at number 49 in Sweden. The band did plan to release Don't Blame Your Daughter, Diamonds in the UK in April 2006, but this was cancelled because of the poor performance of the album and the first single. Instead, a two-track digital single was released to iTunes. Promos were sent to radio in Europe for Godspell to be the third single from the album, but a full commercial release never materialised. To date, Don't Blame Your Daughter, Diamonds is the last single released by the Cardigans. South American festival tour proceeded in September 2006 before the band parted ways once again. They're glistening like diamonds, go out and find them, but don't blame your daughter. In 2006, Magnus restarted their old label Trampoline and became an A&R for it. The first signing was the Swedish pop band The Animal 5, who were a minor success in Sweden and Germany. Bengt and Lazer formed the group Brothers of End, releasing a debut album, The End, in 2009, and follow-up albums in 2011 and 2014, the latter of which featured Nina as a guest vocalist on the track Heat. Nina appeared on the Manic Street Preachers album Send Away the Tigers in May 2007, providing guest vocals on the UK number 2 hit single Your Love Alone Is Not Enough. Best Of was released in January 2008 as a Greatest Hits compilation album. It contained 21 singles and album tracks. There was also a double CD version with rare tracks and B-sides. Both versions of the album contained no new songs, though some tracks had previously been released only in the UK or Japan. It was released in Canada in May 2008 with a different track listing containing only 16 tracks. The album received no promotion by the band, but it would peak at number 5 in Sweden and number 32 in the UK. Go on to record the second A Camp album, Colonia, which was released on the 28th of January 2009 in Scandinavia by Universal and in the UK and mainland Europe by independent British label Reveal Records on the 2nd of February and 20th of March respectively, while in the US the album was released on the 28th of April 2009. The album peaked at number 2 in Sweden and number 10 in the UK independent album chart. Stronger Than Jesus was released as the lead single from Colonia on the 19th of January 2009. In Sweden, the song spent 11 weeks on the chart, eventually peaking at number 8, making it their most successful single to date in the region. Love Has Left the Room was released as the second single in the UK and Ireland, whilst the track My America became the second Swedish single. An EP of outtakes, entitled Covers, was released to digital format on the 9th of June 2009 in support of the album. I will forget you if you will forget me. I'll slip your mind. Fatal time. This love is my last, my final possession. Most violent caress. It's a beautiful mess, and it's deep down, down. A Camp supported the US release of Colonia with a tour, which began in New York City on the 26th of May and completed on the 15th of June in Los Angeles. Give back the pieces of dreams that you sell me, they trick my mind.
No, but I was going to say with The Camp that I've just recently, Niklas had a kid too, so we've just had a natural sort of time when you're focusing on different
things.
You
need things to sleep.
Yeah, but I just recently got a big urge to call him and to see him and to sort of, and when we hang out, it becomes music eventually. So I'm not closing any doors. I'm just sort of slow and lazy. It takes me 10 years to recover from things and to start up new.
Yeah, I think.
In 2010, Nina appeared on Danger Mouse and Sparkle Horse's collaboration, Dark Night of the Soul, singing Daddy's Gone with Mark Linkous. To make a little money, you
gotta get paid. I don't know what you're looking for. You have nothing in me, that's for sure.
In 2012, the Cardigans received a lucrative offer from Hultsfred Festival to perform the album Gran Turismo in full. After initial hesitation, the band decided to accept the offer, as, according to Nina, it felt like a good way of tearing them out of their strange new everyday life. Peter Svensson declined to participate, although he had no objection to the band touring without him. They therefore recruited singer-songwriter Oscar Humlebo to fill in for Peter and asked their agent to seek more shows for them to play at. The band would end up performing in Poland, Finland, Russia, Indonesia, Taiwan, and Japan. Most of these shows involved performing Gran Turismo in full, followed by an assortment of hits from their other albums.
Why was it time for you to become a solo artist?
It was because I have, during all my years up till now doing music, I've been like, oh, I don't think I would never be a solo artist. I would never do that because I've been loving being in my different bands for all reasons. But now, as I said, I have a kid. He's 4 now. And when it was time for me to, when I started to get excited to work again, I was like, but how am I going to, how's this going to happen? Because when you have other people depending on you, when you're band members, you know, when if I say I can't do it on Wednesday, there's going to be 4 other people being like bummed out, kind of. And I couldn't really deal with that, I felt like. So it was a good time to be moving on my own, kind of. It just made me much more flexible. I didn't have to disappoint people or also, and the other way around, I wasn't depending on other people, you know, coming running when I called.
As I ride on these rails, that's my life, laying rail as I ride.
So we're here in Gothenburg at the Svenska Grammophonstudion, and we're doing the second chunk of recordings for my solo record, my first solo record.
There'll be dust in my eyes, and oh, God knows I can try, but I don't make the rules.
You'll be on the B part then. And then maybe it would come back in just like on the ones, like when the verses.
We are Nina Persson, Nathan Larsson, and Eric Johnson. And Staffan Persson has been working with us too for a couple of days. And the first chunk of recordings we did earlier this spring in Brooklyn, New York, in a fantastic studio, another fantastic studio called Vinegar Hill.
By laying rails for my daughters and sons.
This is kind of stupid. In a good way.
I like
it. I love it. I love it too, but that's why it's rock. It's kind of stupid.
I think it's hot. So we're at 3:10 on this time.
Which is keys.
Just one. Just one. Yeah, totally.
That would be great.
And I was even thinking this double, like, I could almost lose that.
My animal heart's telling me to flee.
Animal Heart. What inspired that?
I just thought, I think that was the same thing we were playing around. I thought that that song Animal Heart was going to be a total old school disco song. I'm a huge Donna Summer fan, so I was seeing my moment to do that. We didn't go that far exactly, but I also, the first lines I came up with when we were writing it was, my animal heart is telling me to flee. And I just sang that over and over again. And I could, then I, when I was going to sit down and actually, you know, draft out the whole song, I was like, I cannot abandon that. And it's also, it was also just very, lots of images came to. And it also, that is really part of a theme that I've been writing about a lot, which is sort of, again, it's the old love fool theme, you know. It's about how you sort of, you can be a very sophisticated person, and when it comes to sexuality, you just lose your chops completely. Animal heart. Yeah. And the primitive, to instinct, and how primitive you get, how primal it is.
Nina would release the album Animal Heart under her own name on the 29th of January 2014. A video for the title track of the album was released in November 2013. The album peaked at number 2 in Sweden, number 14 in Denmark, and number 23 in the UK independent album charts.
What was your original vision for your solo album Animal Heart?
Well, I'm really happy with it, but it's not, I think I had automatically thought that if I would do something solo, it would be more sort of folky, rootsy, you know, because I've been sort of touching that kind of music a lot before, and I thought that, well, that's what you do when you're a female singer, I guess, sort of. But then when I started to write with the people I wrote with, it was just like, this is kind of boring. So we just decided to keep it to be like, you know, pretty traditional format songs. It's verse and chorus, that kind of thing. But to just try to produce it in a bit more sort of exciting way, more modern. Like, and I was also excited to not be in a band where there has to be a guitar player that needs to be featured. So I was like, I'm just going to have no fucking guitars this time. And more just dive into, my husband has a great collection of vintage keyboards and analog synthesizers and stuff. So we just decided to make it a little bit more electronic. It's still not like a dancey thing at all. But since I grew up in the 80s listening to what was on the radio then, I really have a soft spot for lots of those great sounds.
There's something very haunting about your album.
It sounds great. I like to hear that. I don't know. I think I couldn't tell because I'm too
close to it.
Too close to it. But I love to hear you say that. Face down on the
floor of the discotheque. Food for the Beast would follow as the second single. It said, run, 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 get your fur boots on, baby. So long to the beast. March 2017, the entire lineup of the Cardigans reunited, where they were inducted into the Swedish Music Hall of Fame.
Väldigt, väldigt rolig och kan vara väldigt, väldigt tråkig.
Eller hon är verkligen så att om hon är på jättegott humör och kommer in i rummet så märks det. Och vice versa, om hon är på dåligt humör liksom, så då blir man så bara, oj då. Det kan bli liksom extremt jobbig stämning och sådär.
Hon är jävligt känslig, men hon har också jävligt god, hon har jävligt god känsla för saker och ting. Hon är bara lite känsla skulle man kunna säga.
Ska berätta Magnus?
Det är jag som håller ihop skit.
Ja. Men det är faktiskt sant, han är fritidsledaren. Han är vakthunden. Sådär.
Med frihet under ansvar och fallera. Våra kompisar brukar beskriva att Nina och Peter sitter längst fram i bilen och Lasse och Bengt längst bak och jag är den som försöker bråka för att komma fram mellan framsätena och lägga mig hela tiden.
Det är nog på grund av hans storlek som han oftast intar den rollen också att att han ska hålla reda på sitt barn, som man brukar säga. Han är ett år äldre, men i verkligheten så är han... har han passerat 50, tror jag.
Om man till exempel jämför Magnus och Peter. Om man frågar hur är läget sen? Jo då, jag är lite förkyld. Medan Peter, han, liksom, han kanske inte ens säger att han har 40 graders feber. Ja, han är stenhård på det sättet.
Finns det genier så är han ett geni. För det är han faktiskt på att göra musik.
Lite tveksamt att säga så kanske, men drivkraften liksom då, om man ska ge, det, ge våra roller någon slags bild sådär, så är jag väl den som driver på liksom och sådär. Lite sådär självutnämnt och jobbigt. Men det kan krävas ibland i det här gänget. Hade inte jag gjort det så hade det nog inte hänt någonting ibland.
Baktakt. Har du hört ordet öva?
Han är Sveriges kanske bästa trummis för att han har sånt eget uttryck.
Han skulle få svårt att livnära sig som studiotrummis när vi lägger ner för att allting skulle låta som Karin som han spelar på.
Han har ett fantastiskt sånt, i alla fall yttre lugn liksom. Jag hoppas inte att han är lika lugn inuti hela tiden liksom. Det vore inte friskt.
Han behöver inte andas så är han skitrolig ändå. Sådär, en blick. Säger tusen ord. Lasse Johansson.
Och han har en fantastisk... en fantastisk hjärna som man skulle vilja kliva in i lite oftare.
Vad man ska säga att jag tillför i det här bandet är kanske... det är nog dålig humor, tror jag. Slow dancing tight, my barren heart and I.
vi gör kommersiell musik fast med någon liten knasig knorr på det hela. Vi är ju fortfarande inte Celine Dion. Å andra sidan så är vi ju inte heller Neubauten. Så någonstans mitt emellan Neubauten och Celine Dion, där hittar du Cardigans.
Du vet, ibland kan man få gåshud när man hör sin egen musik. Då känns det som att då är man framgångsrik. Så att när man blir lycklig av det man själv tillsammans med andra har åstadkommit på något sätt. Det är extremt häftigt.
Som jag håller på med det, så gör jag det mer och mer för att jag älskar det faktiskt. Det gjorde jag inte från början, men jag har lärt mig att älska det.
På senare år så är det här med framgång, tror jag. Jag har omvärderat det lite, tror jag. Framgång för mig har bara blivit att få ihop det på något sätt. Det är ändå någonting som är känns extremt framgångsrik och stort när man känner att man kollektivt har gjort någonting som alla tycker är bra liksom.
Ja, jag menar, Peter skriver jättebra låtar, Nina sjunger fantastiskt. Men sen är det som ett litet kollektiv liksom, av att man hjälper varandra genom allting på något sätt. Men sen, ja, sen såklart, det är inte bara att hålla ihop som gäller, utan det är att det ska bli bra också.
Jag tycker det känns konstigt, men det är väldigt trevligt om folk uppskattar att vi håller i och fortsätter spela. So
Cardigans, still minus Peter, continued to tour throughout the world and in June 2018 announced a four-day UK tour in December to celebrate the 20th anniversary of Gran Turismo, in which they would perform the full album once again. Nina occasionally guest features on other artists' records, and the Cardigans are still considered to be an active touring band. Whether we will hear new music from them remains to be seen. However, their catalogue of hits and wonderfully crafted albums continue to be loved and adored by fans worldwide. Here's hoping this isn't the end of the Cardigans. Thanks for watching.
The same old fucking you.
Would you like to record a new Cardigans record?
Yes, I would. And we talk about that sometimes, but it's really hard to figure out how the hell we would do that, because we're spread out over the world and people have day jobs and night jobs and tons of kids and all that. It's much harder now, because a couple of us would have to leave. You know, we would have to go away. And all these things are just bigger projects these days. So I don't know that it's going to be possible, but we keep sort of revisiting it. Just I think the will is there, so we just need to sort of, it's not going to happen anytime soon, but we are and especially we need to enthuse our songwriter to be as enthusiastic as the rest of us.